स्टूडेंट्स वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग. सो स्टूडेंट्स इन लास्ट क्लास वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द स्ट्रेस स्ट्रेन रिलेशनशिप इन अ वायर. सो एज अकॉर्डिंग टू द स्ट्रेस स्ट्रेन रिलेशनशिप वी हैव सीन नंबर ऑफ केसेस लाइक इन अ वायर व्हेन यू विल स्टार्ट टू अप्लाई स्ट्रेस ऑन दैट देन वायर विल स्टार्ट टू स्ट्रेन एंड अप टू अ लिमिट लाइक अप टू द पॉइंट ए वी हैव सीन वी हैव द प्रोपोर्शनल लिमिट मीन्स अप टू देयर स्ट्रेस एंड स्ट्रेन बोथ आर डायरेक्टली प्रोपोर्शनल टू ईच अदर मीन्स अ लीनियर रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन स्ट्रेस एंड स्ट्रेन इज देयर एंड दैट्स वाई द ग्राफ दैट इज लीनियर ग्राफ एंड इट इज ओबेइंग हुक्स लॉ देयर एंड बियॉन्ड दैट वन द ग्राफ स्टार्ट टू बी कर्व्ड मीन्स हुक्स लॉ इज नॉट ओबेड देयर बट स्टिल the body has the property of elasticity. So up to some limit A to B we have seen the elastic limit. Then again when going from B to C the body starts to be feel deformation and we have seen a point C up to which if you will just remove the stress then body will get some permanent set in that one. So it means that body start to be deformed. Beyond that limit even without application of any stress the body start to gain strength means the flow in the wire that starts to begin even without the application of stress that will starts to be deformed and that range is known as plastic range. So here that plastic range if you will see that is from some point C to D we have seen then again D to E the body starts to even obey again the Hooke's law means stress if we will apply then strain will be produced and ultimately one ultimate stress point is reached after that if you will apply the stress then wire will break down. So a breaking point after we have got. So this was the whole of the stress strain relationship graph that we have seen and now behavior of wire for the application of stress we have seen. Now let's see the classification of elastic materials based on stress strain wire relationship that we have seen before. So first kind of material is here elastic material that we can classify based on that is called ductile material. So let's see now the first kind of material. This is ductile material. The second one is brittle material. And the third one we can classify that is elastomers. So these are now the three materials that we can easily classify, we can understand by the help of stress strain relationship that we have studied. So let's see now the first one ductile material. Ductile material are those whose plastic range is very greater means if you will see the after the elastic limit the plastic range that is the point from C to D that we are getting that is very large means they have the large plastic range and due to that one if you will apply the stress on these kind of material then they will starts to be deformed, they will starts to only flow, so the flow down behavior in the plastic range means now these kind of materials can be used to form the seats because they can bear a large stress here without going to be break up. Means if they have the large plastic range means large deformation they can bear and that's why we can just transform them into the seats and other one. So that's why these materials are used a lot in making like spring and seats. So example of these material if you will see that is now copper, silver, iron, aluminium. So these are materials are ductile materials that we are using to construct the seats or springs here. So the first material I think that is now clear, they have the very large plastic range, their properties. Now what is the brittle material, the second type of material? So these are those materials whose plastic range is very small, means they are showing very small plastic range and after even that one means after the elastic limit if you will apply very small stress then they will break down. See, their breaking point and the plastic yield point you can say that is very near to each other and that's why these materials easily separated or they breaked out whenever we are applying some stress on these kind of materials. So these are known as brittle material means easily that can be breakable. So here these kind of materials if you will see we cannot obviously use in them to construct or make seats or springs here. So if you will see examples of these materials, then like cast iron and glass, you have seen you are applying the stress on the glass, then easily they are breakable. So these are now this material here. This is another brittle material. The next type of material, that is called elastomers. So elastomers are what? Elastomers are those material for which stress and strain variation is not a straight line. First of all, these materials are not obeying any way the Hooke's law. Even within the elastic limit, they are not obeying the Hooke's law. So for these one, these kind of material, if you will plot the stress strain graph, and obviously if we will take a strain and then stress on this one, so this graph within the elastic limit is obtained in this way. Means up to the point O to the point B, B was our with the elastic limit, as in last class we have discussed. So this graph, you can see this is not the curved graph, this is not linear graph, this is curved graph. So it is not obeying obviously Hooke's law. So these are the material that disobey first of all the Hooke's law. Next one, such materials have no plastic range. Means these materials, they will extend or they will have only the elastic range. After that, they will have break point, no any plastic range. Means we cannot convert these kind of materials into seats or anyone. Next one, if you will see the breaking point, just now I am telling you breaking point is near to the elastic point. If examples of these materials you will see, like rubber you have seen, and the elastic tissue of a rotor, the large vessel carrying blood from the heart, these all are examples of elastomers. So exactly elastomers and their property, I think that is now clear. So there are these three materials that can be classified by using stress strain graph that we have studied before. Now after this one, students, let's see the some other factors regarding to the elastic materials or regarding to the machineries or the bodies that we are using. So in that one, the first topic that we will discuss here, that is elastic after effect. So let's see now the next topic here. That next topic is elastic after effect. So what is now elastic after effect? So if we know that if we will remove the deforming force from the elastic bodies, then they regain their original shape and size or original configuration. And some elastic bodies regain their original configurations immediately, but few others take some times to regain it. So the time taken by them to regain it, that is known as elastic, or the you can say the phenomena of the taking time to regain their original shape and size, that is known as elastic fatigue. So if you elastic after effect or fatigue, like we can say or define it in one word, the temporarily delay in regaining the original configuration by the elastic body after the removal of deforming force is known as elastic after effect. So if the elastic after effect, you will see that is near about negligible for the quartz and phosphor bronze, and means these materials takes very small time even to recover or to regain their original configuration. That's why we are using them in clocks, we are using phosphor bronze to make galvanometers. So these are very important materials, and their due to their property of elastic after effect and their also property of elasticity, we are using them. Next, if you will see like glass fiber, so glass fiber that is taking very last time to regain their original shape and size. So it means elastic after effect is very greater for glass fibers. Next, after this one, the next topic that we have to study, that is after elastic after effect, is elastic fatigue. So let's see now what is elastic fatigue. Elastic fatigue. also when any elastic body that is subjected repeatedly to action of suppose any deforming force, then the behavior corresponds to that elastic materials that changes. And also just like when human bodies, they are just your humans, they are working repeatedly, then they feel fatigue after some or they feel tired whenever they are working for several hours or several even they are working a lot. So in the same manner, the elastic body is also feeling fatigue if repeatedly they will be subjected to the deforming force. So this kind of behavior of elastic bodies, that means they are showing like they are tired. So you can understand this by the experiment. Means you can take suppose two elastic discs, and one disc is suppose A and B, two discs you have, and don't use disc A, only use disc B, and just try to just suspend both of them continuously, make rotation, or you can say if you are you have suspended, then you can give it oscillation. So due to continuous oscillation, you can calculate the time period of that one, or number of oscillation in 1 second that is performing, like frequency you can calculate. And now after a certain number of times, suppose 10 times you have given oscillation to the B1, and you have calculated the frequency. Now again give A and B both the same oscillation, means same displacement to oscillate, then you will find out the body A that will oscillate more in 1 second in comparison to the body B, even for the same displacement, same length of wire, same suspension, same kind of materials, same weight, same mass, everything, they are identical in every manner, but still the body B will show some of the like tired property in comparison to the body A. Like it has, it is now tired after doing some work. So this behavior of the body, that is known as elastic fatigue. So if we have to remove the elastic fatigue in any body, then like we human are doing, we are taking rest. After that, we again feel energetic and we can do work. So just like leave the instrument to take some rest, leave for some time, exactly I'm saying this one, and after that they will be again, they can be used as a rest. So this is now the effect, elastic fatigue, very interesting effect that the materials are showing here. Next one, in this case, if you will see the application of elasticity. So let's see the next topic here, application, where we are using the knowledge of elasticity. We have studied a lot where we are using, so some of the idea I think you have already. So the if you will see the knowledge of elasticity, like just now we have classified the material ductile, brittle and elastomers. We have seen they have different properties, and due to their different properties we can use them at different places. Like we know which kind of material is suitable to make seats or springs, which of the materials is breakable easily. So this kind of knowledge we know already by you just a knowledge of the elasticity. Next one, if you will see like the metallic part of the machinery is that are subjected, if we will subject them beyond the elastic limit, then they can get some deformation or even they can be breaked. So here, like just like in stress strain relationship, we have seen up to the elastic limit, up to we are seeing different kind of materials, and some of the materials are even get their breaking point after the elastic limit, some of the materials get breaking point beyond the elastic limit, but at least above the elastic limit they are getting deformation. So if machineries, they will be subjected beyond their elastic limit, then that time obviously they will be deformed, and we will need a new machine to work there. So always what we are doing, we are subjecting the deforming force to the machinery to a particular limit, and already limit is set for every material. So that's why we can use, like if any of the weight machine that can weigh only 100 kg, then you cannot subject greater than 100 kg to that machine, otherwise that will starts to be deformed. So this is now the application of elasticity that we are using. Next one, the application, if you will see, like we are using suppose cranes, and increase the rope we are using, we can have by using elasticity, we can have the knowledge how much stress it can produce, like how much load it can be, it can bear. So for that one, what should be the length of the rope, what should be the area of the rope, to bear a particular stress. So we are designing even crane rope for a particular length and area, or we are providing it particular diameter to lift up some of the weight from there. So always a single crane we cannot use for every weight, for every load. So different cranes and their ropes we are using there. So this knowledge of elasticity tells us about that one also. Next one, we are using the knowledge of elasticity for safety purpose. Like if we know beyond this limit the force is not good for the bodies or machinery, then that time we are not using it beyond that one. We are just keeping our limit even below the elastic limit. That's why our work, our machineries, our everything will be just in safety manner. So these are all the example, you can see the applications of knowledge of elasticity in our daily life. Next one, after this topic, one topic students we have studied already in the case of work power energy chapter, like elastic potential energy. Means in what is the potential energy that is stored in any elastic bodies, that we have discussed already before. So that's why again here we are not going to discuss that one topic. After this one, let's study the next topic of this chapter, and that is now Poisson's ratio. So let's see now what is Poisson's ratio. Poisson's ratio, this concept arises in context of the change in configuration in or change in length exactly. So whenever we are changing the length of any material, then that time with its change in length, also its area is changing. So you will see if you are extending or you are stretching a wire, then that time wire get thinner. So it means that the radius of the wire, that is also changing, or diameter is also changing. So it means we have neglected, while studying the Young's modulus of elasticity, we have taken only the concept of length there. But even along with length, there is also one kind of strain changing diameter that occurs also. So Poisson's ratio is what? Poisson's ratio is exactly the ratio of these two kinds of strain. So first of all, one as a change in length per, to the original length, this we are knowing by the longitudinal strain. So longitudinal strain we have discussed already. This is now change in length, or we can write, suppose any of the wire we have that has length L. So if suppose this is now the wire and we are subjecting them to any of the pores, and due to subject of the pores the wire get thinner. So suppose the change in length is first, that is delta L, original length is L, and the diameter of this wire is suppose that is capital D, and now the change in diameter, that is suppose delta D. So this is now the change in diameter. So if length will increase, then obviously diameter will decrease, and if length will decrease, then that time diameter will increase. So this relationship you have to keep in your mind. So here the longitudinal strain we can define it by change in length to the original length. Now a change in diameter, this formula, change in diameter to the original diameter, this is now also one kind of strain, and this strain is known as now lateral strain. So this is now the next kind of strain that is studied by the person, and this is given as lateral strain is equal to delta D by D, and as this is decreasing with increase in length, so that's why one quantity will be always negative. So we have taken it just negative, like length is increasing then diameter is decreasing. So Poisson's ratio is what now? Poisson's ratio, that is defined by that is denoted by sigma, and this sigma is equal to longitudinal strain to the lateral strain. This is just sorry for this one. This should be reversible, not this one. this is now lateral strain, sorry for that, lateral strain to the longitudinal strain. So it means that lateral strain we have, that is delta D by D, and longitudinal strain is what? This is delta L by L. Now you can calculate it also in the terms of radii. So as if you will write the diameter in terms of radius, so 2 times delta R will be here, 2 times D, and 2 will be cancelled out. So it can be written as delta R by R to the delta L by L. So this is now the Poisson's ratio. So here if Poisson's ratio, that negative sign you know already, that is showing that with increase in length, diameter or radius is decreasing. And if you will calculate the Poisson's ratio, then its value comes out to be between minus 1 to plus 0.1. So its value always lie in the range minus 1 to 0.5. So this is the range of the Poisson's ratio for all materials that we are obtaining. So here the Poisson's ratio, where it will help us, this kind of derivation, it helps us to first to correct our concept about the Young's modulus of elasticity, or whenever there is change in length. And the second one, it is helping us to derive a relationship between all elastic constraints. So as we have three kind of elastic constraints, so we can find out relationship between all them. So let's see now what is the relationship between these elastic constraints now. So our next topic is Poisson's ratio and elastic constraints. So this derivations you don't have to study, but you can see the relationship between, now we have three elastic constraints: Young's modulus of elasticity, bulk modulus of elasticity, and modulus of rigidity, and the last one, that is Poisson's ratio. So these four are interrelated with each other by some formulas. So we can write it. So the first one, relationship between any three at a time you can take. So this is now y is equal to 3b. Here this is 1 minus 2 sigma. So this is our first relation. Second relation is here, that is relating y is equal to 2 eta. Here this is 1 plus sigma. The third one, here you can see this is now 9 by y. This is equal to 1 by b plus 3 by eta. So these are now three equations that are relating all, you can say, elastic constraints. These four elastic constraints that we are seeing, also this is ratio is also one kind of constraint. These all constraints are helping us to calculate any of the behavior of the material. Means if we know already the Poisson ratio for the material and we know the Young's modulus of elasticity, then without any calculation from this formula we can calculate bulk modulus. Similarly, we can also calculate the modulus of rigidity. Means from the single information we can have all informations if we know the knowledge of only Poisson's ratio. And again, if you can have these any two, you know, so you can find out any one from here. Also the three are related by this formula. So this is now the relationship for these all. So students, I think in this chapter about the elastic materials, applications, elastic constraints, all whatever we have discussed, I think that is now clear up to here. So students, in this chapter, I think the topics that we have studied, I think that is now clear. So up to from this topic, our chapter is now ended here. So we have ended our next chapter now, elasticity. So again, if one word I will summarize it, in elasticity we have started with the knowledge of the elasticity. What is the elasticity? Means property of opposing the change in configuration of any material, that is known as its elastic property. And later we have seen how many kinds of elasticity it can have, and also what kind of effect the system can show. How can we classify the materials if we have the knowledge of elasticity, how, where we can use it. So all these things we have I think seen. So students, I think whatever we have discussed, that is now clear. So let's end our class and chapter here. In next class, we will start the new chapter, that is mechanical properties of fluid. So for today, let's end it here. Thank you, students.